When they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Thy feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. I don't know about you, but I'd rather be a gatekeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. Amen. Has God been good to you?
Yes.
Has he been good to you?
Yes.
I will bless the Lord at all times. And his praises shall continually be in my mouth.
Amen.
So let us magnify the Lord. Let us exalt his name together. Yes. Let's bow our heads, beloved. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we are on Palm Sunday.
Thank you, Jesus.
Before Easter. We're so grateful and so thankful because you are great.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus, touch our spirits, bind our souls, touch the bereaved soul, the bereaved heart.
Yes,
touch,
Lord,
Heavenly
Jesus,
Father, those
yes,
who are away
yes,
from us, our family
you,
members.
Thank
you for those who have signed into Facebook and in YouTube. We thank you for them. Lord, yeah. Let us be united in the sweet healing balm of Gilead.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
And all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Beloved, thank you so much for joining us at home. I'm Pastor Gerald Bell. I'm pastor and founder of Strongtower Church Boston. We meet here at 710 Turnpike Street in Stoughton, Mass. We meet, we gather at 8:30 on Sunday mornings, and we come Facebook Live at 9:30 a.m. We're so grateful that you've taken time out of your busy schedule to join us this morning. Beloved of God, we also are thankful for those who give online. Rent's due this week. We don't own the building. Amen? But thank God we don't have to do rent parties no more. Amen? Just ask God and he provides. Won't he do it?
Yes, he will.
He'll make a way. So, beloved, he does it through your generous tithes and offerings. How do you do that? You text the words Strongtower Boston 833-831-6388. That's how you give. Or you can go to our website and give online. strongtowerchurchboston.org. On our website, there'll be a link that you can give online. We thank you. Those of you who are here can give from your phone, or we even still do it the old-fashioned way. We take an offering if you're here. Beloved, tell somebody, tell a neighbor, come out and join us. We're vaccinated. We still wear a mask, those. We're boosted. So please feel free to join us in person. Today, beloved, I also want to remind you that on Wednesday evenings, what time, Erica? Wednesday evening?
6 o'clock.
6 p.m. 6 p.m. Wednesday evening. We have an opportunity for Minister Tennille Woods, who has been teaching and preaching for many, many years. She comes on Wednesday at 6 p.m. and serves this community.
Yes.
Amazing. She's an amazing teacher. And we thank God for her. She helps the pastor in any way she can, and she feeds our community with the word of God. She's an excellent teacher. Amen.
Amen.
So, as we are here today, let's get ready for the word. Are you ready for the word?
Yes.
All right. So, in the book of Mark, let me get my glasses. We're going to begin in chapter 11. So before we begin to read, I want you to write this title down, this sermon title, Making Sense Out of Nonsense. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Making sense Amen. Out of nonsense. And so let me give you the context before we read the scripture so that you'll get a sense of where we're going with this. In our church, in the traditional church, Palm Sunday, which we have, is, and thank you, I know for those who've got Palm Sunday, you have to be separated. Amen. I remember the deacons used to separate the palms. Amen.
Amen.
Is the Sunday before Easter, the traditional Palm Sunday. And with the Palm Sunday, it is called the triumphal entry. And for the triumphal entry for Jerusalem into Jerusalem with Jesus and his disciples, they came to Jerusalem for the Passover. Amen? So now, what ended up happening is that there were events to lead up to the crucifixion. More was happening than just waving, Hosanna, Hosanna. Mm-hmm. So what I've been doing in the last few years is I've been looking at the context of what happens during the triumphal entry. So this is what our text is today, because everything in life is not always so clean cut, clear, and dry.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen. Mm-hmm. You go to Palm Sunday, you buy the palm. You get the egg, you dye the Easter egg. Does anybody even do Easter eggs anymore? Praise God. So I remember we get into these traditions.
Mm-hmm.
A few years ago, First Lady and I had the great life-changing experience to actually be in Greece, in Athens, on the actual Greek Orthodox Easter.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Wow.
Yes. And we were there because, remember, the Greek Orthodox was before the Catholic Church.
Mm-hmm.
So they go back to Paul and they would say, Christos Anestes, Alitos Anestes. You know, and we were there at the Parthenon, right where Paul spoke, celebrating the Greek Orthodox Easter. Awesome. Amen, which is typically done after our Easter.
Wow.
So we've got all these traditions, but you and I know life is not that clean and clear cut. So it is in this backdrop we're going to go to the word. So begin at verse 12, and then we're going to skip over to verse 20. So read verse 12. The next day, as they were leaving Bethany, Jesus was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fruit tree in leaf, it's a fig tree in leaf, he went out to find if it had any fruit. And when he reached it, he found nothing but leaves, because it was not the season for figs. But then he said to the tree, may no one ever eat fruit from you again.
Mm.
And the disciples heard him say, now, skip to verse 20. Watch this. The next day, it says, in the morning, as they went along, they saw the fig tree withered from the roots.
Mm-hmm.
Peter remembered and said to Jesus, Rabbi, look, the fig tree you cursed has withered. Have faith in God, Jesus answered. Truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believes that what they say will happen, it will be done for them. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours.
Amen.
Yeah. And watch it. Watch it. I got to keep going to verse 25. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive your sins also.
Amen.
Jesus. May God have a blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy and righteous word.
Thank you.
The story of the fig tree does not make any sense at all. Say, preach, Pastor.
Preach, Pastor. All right.
This story does not make any sense. Why? I'm going to give you three reasons. Why? First, a fig tree could not bear fruit in April because it wasn't the season for figs. That's what it said right there, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't the season. But Jesus went over and cursed it anyway. Second, this story is also captured in Matthew chapter 21, verse 18. Write it down. You can go check it out. Matthew 21, verse 18. And Matthew says that the fig leaves wither immediately. While the Gospel of Mark, which was written first, says that the fig tree withered the next day. Come on, preach.
All right, now.
See, y'all be talking about, well, it's in the Bible. It's a whole lot of stuff in the Bible. Am I right about it?
Yes, sir.
So what you see is that Mark, which was the oldest gospel, had one version of the story, and Matthew had another version of the story. And he was trying to clean it up. Y'all see what I'm saying? He was trying to help us make sense out of nonsense. See, help me preach, homie.
Yeah,
so Matthew and Mark. So I'm going to throw this in for free. I would charge y'all extra, but I ain't going to do it. Because the Holy Spirit helped me. Have you noticed how your brother and sister grow up in the same family with the same crazy parents? And then one of y'all see it one way. And then the other sister be like, well, Daddy didn't treat me like that. Am I preaching good, y'all?
Yes, sir.
Am I helping somebody?
Yes, sir.
This is what has to happen in the Bible. You got to start to read the Bible with a critical analysis, with a critical eye. And the third reason is this. Why would Jesus behave and act in such a selfish and self-centered manner that is not consistent with his humble teachings and the conception of his deportment? Why would he curse a fig tree that wasn't even bothering him? That couldn't even bear no fruit? Touch your neighbor, say pressure.
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 He was building up to Easter. And what we don't see here is that the pressure building up to Easter, he knew that the same folk that was waving the palms was going to hang him next week.
Jesus.
He knew that his boy, Judas, was going to betray. Y'all better not make me preach.
Yes.
He knew that Judas was going to betray him. And he was already anxious. Help me, somebody.
Yes,
so stop trying to be more holy than you are.
Amen.
Come on,
amen.
Help me preach, Holy Spirit. Yet this parable has made it into the Gospels. It's made it into the Luke. Why? Because Jesus had to say what he needed to say. What did he say? He didn't even deal with the fig tree. First thing out of his mouth, Barry said, was have faith in God.
Yes.
And then he goes on, he says, you will be able to remove mountains with your words.
Yes.
By speaking words, you will be able to move mountains. What has this got to do with the fig tree? Nothing.
Nothing.
And then he goes on to tell his disciples that if you believe, if you believe that you have received it, it will be yours. And he lets them know that we can have what we ask for when we pray.
Yes.
Now, let me go a little deeper. And I was figuring out a way to say this. I've been struggling with how to say it, but I'm just going to spit it out.
Come on now.
I've got 3 degrees. I've studied in Oxford. I've studied at Harvard and have a fellowship. I know this stuff. I am not, as my mama would say, a jackleg preacher. I'm not. I've studied the commentaries. And I've been to school for this, and I want you to see what the commentaries have said about this text. The commentaries and the historical critical analysis respond in this way to this text, and I quote, it is abundantly clear, and I wrote it down for y'all, it is abundantly clear that these promises are not to be taken physically and literally. Neither Jesus himself nor anyone else ever removed a mountain by prayer. And they go on to say, all of us have prayed with passionate faith, and those prayers have not been answered. And I stopped by this morning to let you know that I totally and sincerely 100% disagree with you.
Yes. Yes.
I disagree 100%. And so I asked the critics this morning, are we to believe the Easter story next week? Y'all telling me that I can't speak to a mountain and it be cast into the sea. You telling me that I can pray, but God might not answer my prayer. But then next week you gonna tell me that they hung him high, stretched him wide, he was buried for 3 days.
Yes,
and then he got up and you want me to shout?
Yes.
I'm supposed to believe that? But I can't believe this? Y'all better help me preach.
Yes, sir.
So if the Easter story is to believe, then why would we place limits on 3 things? I'm not going to place limits. He said have faith in God. Why would I place limits on my faith in God? He said, you got power in your word. Why would I place limits on the power of the spoken word?
Yes.
And if the Easter story is to believe, and why would I not have hope for answered prayer? It don't make no sense. Well, you can't believe that literally. Well, if you come from where I come from, help me somebody.
Yes,
if you've been through what I've been through,
there's
some mountains that needed to be moved.
Yes,
and I know it might not have been Blue Hill Mountain. But it felt like Blue Hill Mountain. when you said you were going to tell Blue Hill to be moved over into Quincy Bay, well, help me somebody. Well, some of the stuff I had to face was that impossible.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Now, this story, this parable, There will be times. There will be situations in your life that will not make sense. You will be unable to comprehend with logic why I have to experience what I'm experiencing. Why I have to go, I feel like crying, I feel like shouting. Why I have to pull my hair out because I got to go through this. Why in the world would Jesus do that? Why would he curse a tree that wasn't even bothering him? Why would he go through? Because he was giving the process of how to get up, get through, and come out on top. So here's my first point and my closing point. Sometimes in life, you may have to curse the fig tree and keep it moving.
Yes, sir.
Mark had it right. Matthew was trying to clean it up. Oh, it was a miracle. The fig tree withered the same day that he spoke. No. He spoke to it, went to sleep. They was moving on to the Passover food. Help me, somebody.
Yes,
and the disciple looked back and said, did y'all see that tree? Did y'all see that tree that he cursed? He said, yeah, I know it, but I want you to have faith in God.
Yes.
Help me, somebody. He was providing a blueprint for his disciples and for us to follow. Y'all supposed to ask me the question now. What is the blueprint, Pastor? Ask me.
What is the blueprint?
Well, I'm so glad you asked. I'm so glad you asked me that question. One, the blueprint is this. Have faith in God, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. Y'all don't want me to preach.
Amen.
I don't care if it's cancer. That's I don't right. care if it's addiction. Woo. I don't care if it's suicide. I don't care if it's alcoholism. I don't care if it's divorce. I don't care if it's separation. I don't care if you lost your job. I don't care whatever it is. I don't care if you lost your best friend. I don't care if you lost your only love or your first love. You got to have faith in God. You got to have faith in God. Whatever it is. Well, what is another step in the blueprint? The next step is you've got to learn how to speak to the mountains in your life.
Amen. Amen.
You've got to open your mouth. Words matter.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Words have power. And when you speak, something's got to happen.
Right. Amen.
And he opened his mouth and he cursed that fig tree. When you speak, the blueprint is, if you need to reset something, talk to it.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to the mountains in your life. Help me, somebody.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
I was at a group of my old yoga family that I practice yoga, and God just put us together about 12 years ago. And we all got together and practiced yoga. And they remember when I was going through my divorce and I was going to get remarried, and they remember Carmen. And a couple of them have gotten divorced. Listen, I ain't got nothing to do with church or this sermon. Help me, son. I'm so tired of people trying to get up in my message. Help me, somebody. There's a point I'm trying to make. So one of my boys said, I'm going to my parents, and they've been married 50 years. Argue all the time. And they leaving here going back. I said, yeah. How you and Carmen doing? I said, we say anything to each other we want to say. She tell me what I want to say. I tell her what I want to say. She said, yeah, but my parents said they don't go to bed angry. I said, that ain't how we do it. If we angry, I still get over there close beside her.
else did. Have I got a witness?
Yes.
You know, I might be the people. Don't be listening to all that stuff that people be saying. Your life is not like their life.
Right.
You can't take all these sayings on Facebook and apply them to their life, your life. They don't apply to you.
Exactly.
Have I got a witness?
Yes, yes, yes.
Y'all better help me pray. Mm-hmm. You got to speak to the problems mm-hmm. in your life.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, beloved, the blueprint is this. When you pray, don't doubt.
Amen.
When you, I couldn't believe Raquel, the historical people, that when the boy said, well, you know, God says slow. Sometimes he says no. Sometimes he says go. Mm. Well, that don't work for me. All of them little sayings don't work for me. Sometimes when I pray, I need God to move. I need him to answer my prayer for real.
Yes.
I don't have time. Help me somebody.
Yes.
I don't have time. Y'all don't know what I, y'all don't know where he lives. Oh, look where he brought me from. Oh, he made a way out of no way.
Yes.
There's been times when it was impossible. We couldn't nobody see it. And I was the only one that could see it and believe it. And I had to keep on praying. I know it made no sense to nobody else, but it made sense to me. Why you doing what you do? Because I got to do it this way. Are y'all with me? Come on, stand on your feet. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Beloved, we're going to close this message now. If no one else can see it mm-hmm. or understand it, you got to keep on believing.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. 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 Can nobody else see it?
Yep.
You got to keep believing.
Right.
So let us pray.
Yes, sir.
Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
We could preach another message on the last thing you said. And that was, forgive your enemies.
Mm, yes.
Lord, I believe Jesus was angry mm-hmm. and cursed the tree because mm-hmm. he couldn't curse next week when they killed him.
Mm. Oh,
I believe he was letting off a little steam.
Mm. Yes, sir.
Because he knew he was going to have to make it to the cross.
Yes.
He knew he was about to be betrayed.
Thank you.
And he just let them know that God can bring a withered tree back.
Mm-hmm.
But if I got to go be about my Father's business, and I cannot curse my enemies.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why he told his disciples, Lord, forgive us. So help us to forgive our enemies in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
Let's clap our hands. Now when the hymn was able to keep you from falling, may the only wise God and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let the Redeemer of the Lord shout, Strong Tower!
Strong Tower!
Strong Tower!
Strong Tower!
Strong Tower!
Strong Tower!
Hope you never say, God loves you, and so do I. Eric, let that play a little bit. God loves you, and so do I.
So do I.
Tell them, help's on the way. Help's on the way. Help's on the way.
Help is on the way.
Help is
on the way.